All right, everyone, welcome back to Speak Black Man. We are live for episode 5 of season 3. We are super excited about this season's conversations and our guests. Now, of course, if you're watching live on Facebook, please know that we are going to be moving to YouTube starting March the 6th. It'll start with the I Win Morning Show, followed by Speak Black Man at 7:15 p.m. on Mondays. And then our Wednesday shows will be on YouTube as well. The students will be back in March. And believe it or not, the students have something to say. So again, welcome guys to Speak Black Man, episode 5 of season 3. I am your host, Jason B. Allen, better known as Professor JBA. Now, if you are viewing, please make sure you visit Educational Entities' website as well as our Facebook pages. There's more than one, and there's a lot of information on social media that may not be on the website. So I always tell people to make sure you connect it to both. If you are watching this live, go ahead and tag or share this with 5 people. Get them connected to tonight's conversation, which I think is timely for tomorrow, which is Valentine's Day, better known as Love Day, but also just getting ready for the season that we're going into. Now, here are some public service announcements. We just had the 4th annual Black Male Educators Appreciation Week here in Georgia. Salute to all of the Black male educators across the nation, specifically here in Georgia. My students and I started this 4 years ago to do our part here in Georgia to get more Black men connected to classrooms, to boardrooms on school boards, making policy and also financial decisions around our schools. Also, got to do this because it's everything that everyone is talking about. Salute to Rihanna, the performance at the Super Bowl. Of course, shout out to the Super Bowl champions. There was a lot of firsts, a lot of excitement. We can see that the NFL is definitely working on diversity. Kudos to them, right? But we also want to see continued growth, seeing more Black coaches of these national teams and also some more ownership of these teams. So, with that being said, guys, those are the public service announcements. We're thankful for you tuning in to this season of Speak Black Man. This episode of Speak Black Man is titled, We Must Talk More About Healing. So again, we're right on time for Valentine's Day, also known as Love Day, and really the season of love that we are in. So we're going to really speak to the urgency of healing our minds, bodies, and spirits. And we have an amazing guest on tonight, and we are going to go ahead, as I'm looking at the background, I believe we're ready. We're going to bring on Brother Mark to be engaged in the conversation. Now, I want to make this preference, guys. You know, this is a live show. Sometimes we're dealing with tech issues while we're on live. Brother Mark, we can't hear you. So we're going to go ahead and move forward with the programming. I want you to tell the people a little bit about who you are, where you're from, and the current work that you're doing.
Peace and blessings, Jason. It's an honor to be here with you. Thank you so much for having me. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. My name is Mark Tuggle. I'm a freelance writer in the Village of Harlem in New York City. I'm also an activist, an educator, filmmaker. I'm a mentor, I'm a playwright and a poet. And I just edited a book called Cultural Silence and Wounded Souls, Black Men Speak About Mental Health. The book is an intergenerational anthology. There's 30 men from all walks of life, advocates, businessmen, clinicians, educators, filmmakers, journalists, lawyers, musicians, et cetera. And each person has contributed an essay about either their personal experience with mental health or their professional views on mental health. So guys are writing about anxiety, depression, isolation, loneliness, PTSD, stress, trauma, paranoid schizophrenia, suicide ideation. And it's really important for Black men in America to address their mental health. So I'm happy to be here with you today.
Brother, I appreciate you sharing that. And it's a heavy conversation. 30 minutes of us focusing in on mental health. I wish it was thousands of people that could hear the conversation. However, those who will get connected will connect and share this information because we need to have more conversations around mental health, support for mental health, health and wellness, health care for Black men. And I think this is also an important conversation touching on how we are also healing the Black family, because that's a deeper conversation that also needs to be had. So I don't want to belabor the time. I'm going to go right into our first question. Now, for those who are tuning in to the conversation, Mark's website is at the bottom of the screen, so you can connect to the conversation through that. But Mark, let's get right into the first question. And it is centered on this. Why is healing important to the advancement of Black Americans, specifically where we are now in 2023? Of course, all of the things and achievements that we have seen and are still achieving. What do you believe is the importance of healing of Black Americans in the advancement of us?
Healing is essential to our liberation as a people. Dr. Joy DeGree has written extensively about post-traumatic slave syndrome in her books and her research, her talks, her science. You know, since our inception here, our enslavement as Africans, you know, we've had to deal with being stripped of our land, our religion, our family, our culture, our art, our music, our food, just who we were, our humanity as a people. We've had to undergo generational trauma from century to century. It's in our ancestral DNA. And so as a result, you know, we're not free as a people. You know, even Dr. King said that an injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Queen of Four talks about how healthcare is self-care. So in terms of our advancement, our liberation as Black people, there's so much in our past that we have not addressed or resolved. We're still coping with white supremacy, white patriarchy, white power, white privilege. And there's so much that we have to unlearn and relearn as a people so we can be free in body, mind, and spirit, like you said, you know, in terms of our emotional liberation, our spiritual liberation. There's so much that we have to deal with. But I really believe that healing begins within, and each person is willing to take that personal journey inward, an honest self-assessment. It can benefit ourselves, our families, our communities, and our nation.
Brother, I'm hoping that people are taking some good notes. Mark's information is at the bottom of the screen. I'm stuck on your answer to the first question in regards to the importance of healing to the advancement of Black Americans. And too oftentimes I feel as if people are in their silos and don't really understand how all of these things connect. I want to ask you this question. Over the history of in America, there has been an intentional effort to separate Black men from their families, from households. You know, depending on where you live, they're in certain areas. You weren't able to qualify for affordable housing if there was a man in the house. So, you know, there are a lot of different moving parts that attribute to the continued separation of the Black family. How do you think that impacts us as Black men on a spiritual, emotional level?
Wow, that's a great question. You know, in certain parts of the country, Black men are not perceived or treated as men. They're perceived and treated as boy. They actually call boy in certain parts of the country. Our gender has been co-opted, in my opinion. You know, when we were enslaved, our gender was insignificant. You know, we were racialized, but we were seen as criminal, as savage, as beast, as animal, and we were stripped from our families, you know. And right now we're dealing with mass incarceration, the prison industrial complex, police brutality. And there's so much trauma that we have to deal with because Black men are constantly being shot in by cops in America. And from 2015 to 2019, American police shot and killed 50 Black women. During that same time period, American police shot and killed over 1,400 Black men. And Black male death is profitable. It's pathologized, it's fetishized. Even the whole Black Lives Matter movement came about through Trayvon Martin being, you know, when he was shot by, I can't think of the guy's name right now, but he was acquitted. And
George Zimmerman.
I'm sorry. Yeah, George Zimmerman. He was acquitted, which is crazy. But that's, the law does not see us as human. Mm. You know, the Constitution still sees us as 3/5 of a human being. And so the laws of the state are really based on apartheid, particularly in New York, where I live at. And our families are suffering because we're not unified. And there's so much, like I said, there's so much that we really have to work through as a people.
Yes, there's a lot that we have to work through. One of the things that I believe, okay. All right, thank you, backstage. One of the things that I believe really would help is making sure that we had more counselors in our public schools. I know that we don't have enough social workers and the task of the social worker in the school. But I definitely think that every Title I school should have a school counselor for each grade level that can implement specific programming for the appropriate age and grade of students. What are your thoughts on more direct social emotional learning support in our schools?
I agree. I think that would be a sane and sound idea, but unfortunately we live in a capitalist society first, and sometimes the school system does not really value our people as human beings, and so we don't get treated as human beings. We live in a digital world now where a lot of people are online on social media. Our attention spans gotten shorter, and a lot of schools don't have a budget for mental health counseling. I remember when Richard Nixon was president in 1970, 1968, he actually had money in his budget for mental health and drug addiction treatment, but that money was switched to the military and the police. And that became the American priority, is to militarize and police our bodies. And so when kids go to school, sometimes they go to school with no breakfast, no father, and no hope. No nutrition. And so the priority for mental health treatment, counseling, social workers is not at the forefront of the U.S. educational system, in my opinion.
Yes, most definitely. Now, I agree with you. I also think that we don't have enough realistic conversations around dismantling systems. And of course, you know, if you are a true activist or advocate or grassroots organizer, you know that the revolution would not be televised. So, of course, if you're really doing the work, most of those things aren't talked about on public platforms anyway. However, there are people strategically working together to make sure that the masses of Black and brown people who are living in poverty or below the poverty line are receiving the basic support. I mean, just basic support like healthcare, you know, shelter, fresh food, or available, you know, not living in a food desert, you know, getting to those basic things. Speaking of this, I want to go to our second question, which is centered on this. What are 3 to 5 things Black men can do to stay healthy?
3 to 5 things Black men can do to stay healthy. Yes, I would begin with therapy. Therapy was very helpful in my life. I also think that exercise is important. I think nutrition is important. I think journaling is very important. Prayer, meditation is important. I think, I'm doing more than 5.
No, that's comedy. Good. Keep going. Look, keep going.
I think comedy is important. You need to be able to laugh. Laughter is good for the soul. Yes. You know, laughter is spiritual food. I think yoga, acupuncture, those are also modalities. Spending time with nature, spending time with animals, spending time with children. Basically doing the opposite of what you would normally do to take care of yourself, because Queen of Fools says the healthcare and self-care, we have to do better with taking care of ourselves.
Yeah, put the phone down. I'm on my phone a lot doing
me too
posts for social media.
Yeah.
And you know, especially when you're an entrepreneur but also working, you know, you're doing it on your own and doing it with a team and having to support them and being engaged. And so, you know, I'm very intentional. Now, I like to be old school. I'm still working on getting the house phone, because I feel like that would help me disconnect from having that phone in my hand, and then every update, everything that's happening in the news, it's like it's constantly coming. So, you know, kind of having some separation, even though we're in the advanced digital era, you know, still having some break.
Do you think having a house phone would limit your use of your cell phone?
Yeah. You know? I mean, and it has worked. I mean, when I leave, you know, my cell phone in the work study, the office, you know, the ringer is not on. So, you know, if you need to reach me, you have to hit me up on the house phone. So I know family, loved ones, they have that. They would have a house number. If it's an emergency after 7 o'clock, you know to hit me up on the house phone, either emergency or you just want to talk. Okay. Like, you go reach me on the house phone because I'm disconnecting from my cell phone. And, you know, to be quite honest, this isn't, there are people who do this not intentionally, but just because of access. If you live outside of the metropolitan area or a large city, you know, access to internet, it happens a lot. I mean, and it was happening, I know, that within the last decade, and even still when we go back to, you know, what we call the home, you know, home country town, where it's not a lot of people, but also access is different. And so, you know, people will say going to the country and access is a little bit different. So for me, that is a practice that works. And it is a, you know, it's a way of living for some people.
Yeah.
So just adding that. But that's on the topic of staying healthy and just having a balance with our devices, not having that device in your hand and in your face all day consistently. So, you know, we got to work on the balance because it is going to be the way of the world soon, but we still got some time. So let's still have a little bit of balance with that.
That balance was very challenging, Jason, for me, because I have my phone right next to me at all times. And, you know, when I get a text message or email, it beeps.
Yeah.
And I feel compelled to pick it up and look and see who's trying to get in touch with me.
Yeah, see that access too. I learned that when I ran for office. I was like, wow, you know, I want to serve people and help people, but do I really want people to have this much access to me? And so yeah, it's just a good practice. I'm just putting it out there for people to consider and think about. Now, in the essence of time, I do want to go to our third question, which is centered on this. What would you say to Black men regarding therapy? And you touched on therapy a little bit earlier, and also meditation, adding this maybe into a daily practice or into, you know, into their lives. I think we saw a lot of extremes with, you know, this brother recently passed away. I want to say his name was Kevin Samuels. Yeah. I didn't really follow his work, but I know he was controversial because I did, you know, hear a lot of that. He passed away here in Atlanta. So, yeah, that was a thing. So maybe not so much of an extremist to sorts, but, you know, just some good practices that Black men can start implementing to add in some of that balance, that sound mindedness, especially things regarding therapy and meditation. So I want to give you some time to speak to that.
I think therapy is an excellent way to learn how to express yourself in a safe place, whether it's once a week, once every 2 weeks, once a month. I was in and out of therapy for almost 10 years, and it really changed the quality of my emotional life. And meditation is really important too. Even if it's for 5 minutes a day, closing your eyes, quieting your mind, being still, listening either to music or to nature, or just no sound at all, having somebody guide you, or even joining a group where people meditate as a gathering. In terms of therapy too, therapy for Black men is pretretty much a new paradigm shift over the last few decades. But historically, we've had a lot of therapeutic conversations, in barbershops, carpools, holiday parties, front porches, kitchen tables, locker rooms, neighborhood picnics, social gatherings, spiritual gatherings, wedding ceremonies. So we do have a history of therapeutic conversation, but the idea of therapy one-on-one can be very frightening, awkward, and uncomfortable. But it worked for me, Jason. I definitely would recommend. It's not a one-size-fits-all solution, but it definitely helped me.
It is a good start. I mean, it definitely, you know, helped me too. And I think that it took, you know, some urging from my family, specifically my parents, to say, hey, you know, we've got to go in a different direction. So before we go in this direction, you know, we think that you need to sit down and talk with someone. And you know how, as men, a lot of times we think we got it. You know, it's under control. Okay, you say I showed up like this, so I could just make these adjustments. And sometimes it's deeper than that. It's more than that. And I think that it is really good. I think that, you know, brothers should definitely check it out. And, you know, I'll even throw this out there. I've had a couple of brothers recently who are barbers who have been on the show, who are entrepreneurs, and you know, the origin of barbers in our community, they were healers. They were original healers. That's their position in the community. And so even if your barber is the person that you, not why they cutting your hair, you know, but maybe in the shop one-on-one and really can, you know, provide some sound advice and help to you, I think that even if we can't get you to a therapist, let's work to get you there. And so that's what I would, you know, just add to that piece around how people can still get support.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an excellent idea. I know that's something that's being done in certain places around the country. Just having that one person that you are willing to trust, which can be a barrier. And
that's good.
Hopefully you learn how to feel safe and take off that mask and learn how to become transparent and vulnerable. You know, I thought 28 years ago, if the therapy was for rich, crazy white people, you know, I did. And I know that's not a unique thought for a black man, but that's just,
no, yeah, yeah. That's why I chuckle. Cause I'm like, I hear that often.
I mean, over 20 years ago, I was diagnosed HIV positive and I became obsessed with dying, you know, thank God I'm here today, fully present. But I had a friend who was in therapy and I took her suggestion and it changed the quality of my life. And wow. We didn't even talk about HIV. We talked about the little boy. You know, I have no children, but I'm a single parent to a little boy who lives inside of me. And I had to learn how to feed and nurture and water his spirit and show compassion and empathy and understanding, because I didn't get that as a child. And so a lot of my needs were not met. And it stunted my growth, you know, physically, mentally, and spiritually. And so being with the therapist once a week for 45 minutes, I got to talk about all the trauma I went through and all the things that I believed, and just learning how to unpack and address and resolve a lot of those feelings that I had, resentments, fears, anger. And I was able to share openly where I wasn't going to be judged or criticized or humiliated. And that was so freeing for me. So now I'm not afraid to talk about nothing.
That's deep, brother, and that's very powerful. I appreciate you sharing that in the space. So if you are watching live, we all got that at the same time, and that's what a powerful testimony is, and that's what it does. So I appreciate that being stated, and hopefully that will encourage others who will tune into the conversation and get connected. Now, Brother Mark, as we get ready to close out the conversation, I do want to ask this. Tomorrow is Valentine's Day. I refer to it as Love Day because, you know, I'm just trying to put a different spin on not the intentional focus of our capitalistic society, right? Which is to capitalize off of Valentine's Day. If you did not know that, that is the reality. This is an industry. There's a lot of money that is made around this season, but specifically on tomorrow. So, what would you say to people who are looking to find a forever Valentine? What would you say should be maybe three or five things? I'm going to say three or five, because if I say three, you may give us five anyway. So what are three or five things that you could say to the audience about if they're trying to find a forever Valentine on tomorrow? What are some things that they should be thinking about or considering to do?
Jason, you asked the wrong person.
I was like, that was on the spot question. So no, I was like, okay.
The only holiday that I value is Kwanzaa.
Now, I love that. And I actually talked about that this morning on our I Win morning show, shameless plug, 7:15 a.m. every Monday morning. join the team, Dr. Danny, JT the Brandmaster, and I every Monday morning. But on the show this morning, I mentioned that I'm not really excited about Valentine's Day. You know, I shared that with my husband. I was like, listen, you know, outside of high school and college, you know, sweetheart, and, you know, I was younger and it was like, that this is cute. You know, let me get you the teddy bear, the gift, the, you know, all of that. But now I'm like, I'm good with a good dinner or, you know, something like that. And we would just be doing that anyway. So I'm good with that. But I mentioned the fanfare around holidays like Valentine's Day. And let me just stick with Valentine's Day. But saying that I wish that our people would put more emphasis behind Juneteenth and Kwanzaa, things that will really, you know, empower our community, bring like investment and, you know, financial growth to our community, stability, healing of our minds, bodies, and spirit in our community for us, like things that we will really benefit from as a culture and community. And so, you know, nobody really wants to hear that conversation, but to your point, I did advocate for that. So I'm going to push for that. That is going to be our closeout for today, that, you know, as Black Americans, listen, you can celebrate as many holidays, much less none, whatever that may look like. But whatever you do, please consider Juneteenth and Kwanzaa in your celebrations throughout the year. So I want to see more investment in our physical bodies, what we're eating, how we are living, taking care of ourselves, taking care of our mental health, also making sure we're watching what we eat and put into our bodies and, you know, the chemicals we put into our hair, being mindful of those things. I really want to see us embrace Juneteenth and Kwanzaa more. So that was it. That's it. Now that's it, Brother Mark. No more questions. Well, I will ask you this. Did you get a chance to watch the Rihanna concert yesterday?
I did. She killed it. She killed it and she's pregnant.
Yeah, she killed it and she's pregnant.
I can't imagine being all the way up that high, having a baby on the way. It's sort of like Serena Williams when she won the Australian Open. She was pregnant when she won.
Yeah. That was one of the analogies that I did see.
She killed it, but people are hating on her because she's not an American. You know what I mean? So people that get mad that her and Shirley Ralph sang, but they're not American born or whatever. It's like this is we
live in a global society. Why? I mean, that's apples and oranges. They live in America. They go to their home countries and support, which I mean, a lot of us don't. This is our home country, so. If, let's be honest, a lot of us ain't going back into the hood and donating and don't even get. I'm not going to go there. But I will say.
I enjoyed it. Did you enjoy the performance?
I did. I thought it was super dope. You know, I can go back to my 20s and I remember it was the debate between like you were either Rihanna Navy or Beyonce Beehive. I don't really think I was either. But I did kind of prefer Rihanna a little more just because she was edgy and. You know, it was her, I don't give a fuck attitude. I mean, right. That was really it. That was right. It. Right. That was the thing for me. I was like, yeah, I like that. It's like, she's really not kind of confined to what they're saying. She's the bad girl. Like, you know, they say the bad girl. It was super dope though. Defiant. And then we are going to end because I know they are like, okay, you're 2 minutes over. But in the 2 minutes, I do want to say that it was super dope. The performance in the air.
Yeah.
I thought that was the moment at the end with Diamonds when it suspended out and it was like, wow, she is really like in the air. You can see the stadium and the people with their camera phones.
It was lit. And her dances were incredible. They were on point.
For her to be pregnant, it was dope. So that's how I'm gonna end this out on doing a shout out for Rihanna. Yeah, you know, they did mention that this is her second child that she's getting ready to have. Of course, the amazing work she's doing with Fenty Beauty, but also they did mention that she is considering and is in the works of doing a world tour, which I really believe that because some of the dancers I follow, one of my former students is in a house that I follow, and they have been doing some rehearsals for two artists, And so I'm excited to see if this tour comes about. If it does, I'll be there. But y'all stay tuned to that. Speak Black Man returns next Monday at 7:15 p.m. Make sure you go to our YouTube channel, subscribe. That way on Wednesday is coming up. It's going to be super dope. Host is Anthony Downer. The students will be returning in March. You know, February is a short month, right? So March is tomorrow. So the student podcast will be back, the No Cap Zone. And, of course, Speak Black Man, I Win morning show on Mondays, 7:15 a.m. and 7:15 p.m. Thank you, Mark, for being on. Peace and love, everyone. Amazing conversation today. Make sure you talk up healing. We got to get healed, y'all. Thank y'all. Peace and love, everybody. Mark, thank you for being on, brother.
Thank you, Jason.
Mark's info is at the end, y'all. We're out. Peace and love.